In this video, we're going to go over how to convert a system of second-order differential equations to a system of first-order differential equations, and we know how to solve those. So, if you've got a system of first-order linear differential equations, the derivative of some vector is a matrix times that vector, we know what the solutions look like. They're linear combinations of exponentials of the eigenvalue e to the lambda t times the eigenvectors. And then you have some coefficients that are related to your initial conditions. Now, we also learned how to solve second-order differential equations where the second derivative was a matrix times the vector. And we saw that whenever you had a positive eigenvalue, you wound up with cosh's and sinh's of kappa t, where kappa was the square root of the eigenvalue. And that whenever you had negative eigenvalues, you had terms with cosines and sines of omega t, where omega was the square root of minus the eigenvalue. But what if somebody gives you a differential equation of the sort where the second derivative is a matrix times x plus another matrix times the derivative of x? This happens a fair amount in the real world. This might be related to friction, for example. This might be a restoring force from a system of springs, and this is the friction. So what happens then? Well, there's a trick to convert any second-order system into a first-order system. So if you have this second-order system with a term that involves x and the derivative of x equals the second derivative, what we do is we define a new variable. I'm going to call it y. Now, I apologize that we've been using y to mean the coordinates of x in a b basis. This is the different usage of the letter y. There are only so many letters in the alphabet. So let's let y be the derivative of x, and then we'll write a differential equation. What's the derivative of x? Well, by definition, it's y. And what's the derivative of y? Well, the derivative of y is the second derivative of x. And our equation tells us what the second derivative of x is. It's ax plus b times the derivative of x. But that's ax plus by. So the derivative of x is y. The derivative of y is ax plus by. So if you make a big vector out of x and y, the derivative of x and y is this big matrix times x and y. And if we call this big matrix M, see, if you originally had, say, a 3x3 system, then this is going to be a 6x6 matrix. You're doubling the number of variables because you have as many y's as you have x's. Okay, so it's a first-order system in twice as many variables. And how can you solve that? Well, you find the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of this big matrix M, and you're off to the races using exactly the same methods as for a first-order system, because it is a first-order system. What's more is you know what the solutions look like. The solutions are always exponentials. So let's do an example with M equals just 1. So we have the differential equation second derivative is minus 2x plus 3 dx dt. So then we package x and the derivative of x into a 2 vector. You see we had a second order system in one variable. We turn it into a first order system in two variables, 0, the identity, a and b. This is a, this is b. And then we have to find the eigenvalues and the eigenvectors of this M matrix. Well, the eigenvalues are 1 and 2. You can see the row sums are all 1 and the trace is 3, so the second eigenvalue has to be 2. And you can work out that the eigenvectors are 1, 1, and 1, 2. And so our most general solution, using everything we know about first-order systems, is that x and y is some constant e to the t times 1, 1, plus some other constant e to the 2t times 1, 2. Now, of course, we'd never actually wanted to know about y. We wanted to know about x. So we just read off what x is. C1 e to the t plus C2 e to the 2t. And of course, y, well, the derivative of e to the t is e to the t. the derivative e to the 2t is 2e to the 2t. Or you could read it off from the second row of this equation. Okay, now this gives a hint about how things behave in general. In general, if m is diagonalizable, then the solutions to our first order system is that this at time t is going to be some combination of exponentials. The exponentials go is e to the lambda t for each eigenvalue. These are eigenvalues of the big matrix, and I'm calling the eigenvector bj dj. So bj is the x part of the eigenvalue, and dj is the eigenvector. So in other words, bj and dj together make the eigenvector of m, and that has eigenvalue lambda. Okay, well, let's spell that out. If m times bj dj is lambda times bj dj, then the first equation just says that dj is lambda bj. So once you know what one of these guys is, the other comes along for the ride. It's just lambda times it. And the second equation says that abj plus bdj is lambda dj. And if we substitute this in here, we can write everything in terms of b, and there's our equation. It's not quite an eigenvalue equation because it involves two matrices, A and B, and it involves a quadratic equation. You got lambda squared over here and lambda B and an A. But if you find values of lambda and vectors B that satisfy this equation, then those are the things that are going to go back in this expansion. And those are the things that are going to contribute to X. Okay, so let's do a 2x2 example using this machinery. So in our 2x2 example, we're going to say the second derivative is given by the matrix 3,3,3,3 times x minus the identity times the derivative of x. So in other words, a is 3,3,3,3, b is minus the identity, and if we wanted, we could write out what m is. M is the zero matrix, the identity matrix, A and B. Now who's up for diagonalizing a 4x4 matrix? Well, didn't hear very many voices, so let's go ahead and do it using this equation. We take AB plus lambda big BB equals lambda squared B. So we're trying to solve this times B minus lambda times b is lambda squared times b. Okay, in other words, 3,3,3,3 b is lambda squared plus lambda b. So in this case, it did turn out to be an eigenvalue problem, except the eigenvalue isn't lambda, it's lambda squared plus lambda. So since the eigenvalues of this matrix are 6 and 0, whenever you have the eigenvalue, whenever you have 1, 1, then this gives you 6b, and you have to solve lambda squared plus lambda equals 6, so lambda equals 2 or negative 3. And with these eigenvectors, this is 0, and you have lambda squared plus lambda is 0, so lambda is either 0 or negative 1. So those are our four solutions. We can put them together. And our most general solution is that x is going to be e to the 2t, that's the first eigenvalue, times the b from the first eigenvalue, e to the minus 3t, negative 3 was the second eigenvalue, b from the second, e to the 0t, that's a constant, b from the third, e to the minus t, b from the fourth. And if you try to do everything in terms of the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of the original matrix, the M matrix, then you would found that the eigenvalues were 2, negative 3, 0, and negative 1, and the eigenvectors were the first b and twice the first b because the eigenvalue is 2, the first b minus 3 times the first b because the eigenvalue is 3, the second b and 0 times that, the second b and negative 1 times that. Okay. last point is, what about the equation second derivative equals ax that we learned how to solve a while ago? How does all this formalism work for this particular problem, which we already know how to solve? Well, if b is 0, then our equations just become ab equals lambda squared b. So the vectors we're looking for are, in fact, eigenvectors of a. But they're not eigenvectors with eigenvalue lambda. They're eigenvectors with eigenvalue lambda squared. In other words, lambda is the square root of the eigenvalue of a, and it can have either sign. When the eigenvalue of a is real, then the square root is positive, and the square root is real, and we called it kappa. When the eigenvalue is negative, the square root was imaginary, and we called it I times omega. So for the positive eigenvalues, you get e to the kappa t and e to the minus kappa t. And we repackage them as cosches and sinches. Cosh of kappa t and sinch of kappa t. When the eigenvalues of a were negative, the square roots of that were imaginary, so we had e to the I omega t and e to the minus I omega t. And you know that e to the I omega t is the cosine of omega t plus I times the sine of omega t. So we repackage that into sines and cosines of omega t. So that was a long slog, but we now see how to take any second order system and turn it into a first order system, and how, when you do that for the familiar ones, you get the familiar answers.